As a lover of history, I found it important as I grew to learn to appreciate and preserve my own family history. As a lover of all things Victorian in that era, and coming from Seattle, I was quite intrigued by anything and anyone that was around in the late 1700s to the early 1800s. My Grandma Betty and Grandpa David, who were in New Bern, North Carolina, shared very special times, albeit short, with me. So there were porch stories, stories from the outhouse to, as I like to say, the White House, stories of things, tobacco, cotton, and New Bern, North Carolina, where it all started. From grits to salmon cakes to sharing the history of New Bern, my cousin Johnny, who's an amazing chef, would delightfully and sometimes begrudgingly take me around. As an American, I found pretty much that New Bern is a story of the Americas. It's the story of immigrants, or people, should I say, coming over, trying to discover a new world and build a new home. It's the story that my Aunt Belle shared with me about New Bern in Pollettsville, the story of the artisans and beautiful craftsmen and people of color that were there, the story of those that were enslaved in the hills and the valleys, and those that chose to continue to work, continue to get out, continue to, according to the law that enslaved them, to be free. And so what I see today, the beauty that was created by many men and women and children, and it was done at a cost. Some were able to enjoy the beauty, some knowing that they too partook in this, that they helped create and build and rebuild. And they would never be rewarded in name, perhaps, or in the history books. But today, I find it joyful that my family had a lot to do and a lot to say. I've been interviewing my Aunt Belle for years and going to try on Palace back and forth, and she shared with me a lot of things that I can pass on to my own two granddaughters and my grandsons. Let me let her talk.
My Aunt Belle, my mother's sister, my Grandma Betty's beautiful daughter. I'm here in New Bern, North Carolina. And I just wanted to share and get some information, oral history on the family. So, Aunt Belle, do you mind? You're how old?
I'll be 86 years old, the 24th of this month, April 24th.
Okay, can you just tell me a little bit about, starting with Grandma Betty and her family? I know she was born in 1910.
My mama was born in 1903.
1903, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Okay, 1903.
Mm-hmm. Daddy was born in 1891. And the Simmons family had a prosperous farm up in Pollettsville, North Carolina, in Jones County. And it was 11 of those children. And the daddy, mama's daddy, was considered, the black people used to call him a wizard because he was so knowledgeable, he was so close to God. And he could always be something like a prophet. And he was a very good man. And he raised his children. My mother was born, it seems strange, when her mother was 58 years old. And she died 3 years later. And it seems kind of strange for somebody in those days to have a child at that age. And the oldest boy was Thomas. He went to Philadelphia. That's where he stayed. And Uncle David, the next one, was an undertaker, prosperous undertaker, in Norfolk, Virginia. And Uncle Aaron was the baby boy, and he stayed in Pollettsville. And my mother stayed in Pollettsville, and mama had a big home in Pollettsville where daddy left her. Uncle Aaron lived next door. They had property all the way down, and they farmed. They had tobacco. That's the most important thing that they had was tobacco. And they had a lot of money in Paulusville. And they were all church people.
A little bit about Paulusville.
Paulusville was supposed to be a... The old one thing about Paulusville, it was no discrimination. No discrimination. The whites and the blacks were just like family. Wow. That's one good thing that I like about Paulusville. Been hearing about it, because when I was three, my mother moved to New Bern, because she married my daddy in 1924.
And we're standing in this house that they purchased and built
in 1938. When my sister was 2 months old.
And that's my mother, right?
Dorothy Lee Stocking. Pretty little, beautiful, one of the most beautiful baby ever came to New Bern. Bow legs.
Oh, gosh. Now, in Paulusville, so you said, yeah, tell me about the brothers, the two brothers.
Abram and Larry. It's ironic. Larry, well, the grandparents were Sioux, full blood Sioux, some of them, okay? And Uncle Larry, Uncle Abram, looked like he was a white man. And Larry, curly haired black man, beautiful, handsome man, but they were inseparable. And my mother's first cousins, yellow, all of them were yellow, and my mother's family were black and beautiful.
Now, was Larry and Abram your mom's brothers or cousins?
Larry was my mom's daddy, and Uncle Abram was my mama's uncle.
So her dad.
And all of his children, he was father of 21 children. He had two wives. The first wife died. Okay. The lady named Blanche, when I was a little girl, I knew that one, that wife. And I knew his children. And it's ironic that all the light cousins loved my mama forever.
That's funny. Yeah, it's
forever.
That's nice.
My mother was the baby of the family.
Nice.
And the Uncle Thomas struck a difference with my mother, because when her daddy passed, he gave my mother a one gold watch. Wow. Before he passed away. And his Aunt Lizzie, my face is her face.
Wow.
It's straight. And she just speaks to my mother all the years and years and years. But her children loved my mama to death.
Oh, wow.
But she used to come from Philadelphia to the bus station and go straight to Paulusville and go out to Tuscarora, where my other first cousin things lived, and never come to my mother, which was the baby, called the one gold watch.
Wow, so people, wow, that's it's amazing. Strange. It is strange.
But her family never, they loved her.
Lovely.
And I knew every one of them.
And so perhaps that's why Grandma Betty was so entrepreneurial, because her father was prosperous.
Yes.
And so, because he had to be born in the 1800s.
Way early. And my mother, in the early days, eighth grade was the high school graduation. And my mother was the smartest one that ever, in those days, that ever went through school, in the eighth grade, in West Street School.
Wow.
She graduated smart.
Wow.
And she taught her children. She taught all, and she married. And me, I got to say something about my daddy, because she married him in 1924 with a newborn. And my daddy, no one knew that he couldn't read or write. He knew the Bible, and he could tell you where to find it. He taught me. That's the reason I became close to the Lord, because of him. And my mother both, but that was it. And I tell you, my daddy was he was a black man, but he was the smartest. Nobody could read a blueprint like Dave Stocky. And when I was a little girl growing up in this very house, and the dining room was right there, close to me. And my daddy, nice, the white men would come around, and he was sitting, they had this big paper, but I didn't know it until later, the blueprint. And my daddy would sit there and tell them what to do about that blueprint.
Wow.
And I did not know he could read. But my baby boy, David, taught him how to read.
Wow, and I do know that he was a brick mason.
He was as smart as he was a brick mason and cement finisher.
Yes, and he did a lot of houses around Newburn, right? He built a lot of things.
You go right down on Broad Street, and every day almost I arrive and I go down Broad Street. This bark apartment, it's beautiful. See, in those days, the white people, the black people had to work under the whites, under their names. And the only thing that still bothers me, it shouldn't though, it does, because my dad's name is not on that on that thing that you're supposed to be building houses. But it's all right though. But let me, the reason that I'm so civic minded, and I believe in equality because when Buster and my brother David, we call him Buster, when we were children, and my daddy was saying, one day my daddy got in a wreck, the Blueberry Taxi, and he had to go to bed, and my mother wrote a note for him to go down to the boss man, Mr. Cuthra, and daddy told us to take that note down to Mr. Cuthra's house on Metcalf Street in New Bern, and he said, if you go to that house and you knock on that door, if they tell you to ground the back, in those days the black people had to ground the white people's back doors, and they tell you to ground the back door, come back. And Buster and I went down there, knocked on the door, and Miss Cuthra came to the front door, and she said, "These are Dave's young'uns." Mm-hmm. Is that what the white people always call you young'uns? "These are Dave's young'uns. Come on in."
Oh,
But I never experienced the spirits going to anybody's back door. If I would have to go to a back door, I wouldn't go.
I know that's right. That's why you are.
And I still like to be up front.
I love it.
So my Aunt Belle gets to share their stories with her grandsons and daughters and all the history of New Bern, the lives that were there, my own history of starting my own peanut roasting business in Craven Terrace and all the other small businesses that actually help make America become what America is. So fascinating, and I'm sure you have your own family stories. For me, knowing that my baby sister, Benita, went to North Carolina A&T, and I was able to pass that on to my daughter, and she, of course, is at North Carolina A&T now. And we were able to enjoy the beauty of the rivers and So much fun. Learning history, sharing our lives, laughing together. So you see, for me, my family history is an American story. A proud American story. Stories of hurricanes, tornadoes, stories of business people and the ability to flourish, the ability to keep moving, to start your own, to preserve your own. I hope you're doing just that.